Doing a documentary and a tribute to Tony. He lives on in the minds of all of his friends and other people that will see his works and said he was a great man, a great artist.
Except for just a dream or two.
He painted vigorously. He did so many things, and each one was a piece of work. But he says they're not all gems, but most of them were.
Belong to you.
It was his passion. He loved painting, and he loved drinking, and he loved.
We're drifting.
Tony cooked Italian food, naturally, and he came to me one day. He says, "My God, I just created a masterpiece." I said, "What's that, Tony?" He says, "I got a 4-foot pizza that'll bust your ass." Tony tried to sell it. He never sold it. It just seems like nobody wanted a large pizza. So Tony, with a bolt of lightning, thought about it, and he said, "My God, I know what to do." And he took it and he sliced it in 8 different sections and sold each section for $25.
That's fate.
As everyone says, if you go to New York and make it, which he never did, go to New York, he certainly would have made it.
I'll soon be turning the tide.
He was the toast of the town. Toast of the town, Tony, that's who he was.
As long as
we didn't want other people to know what we were saying, we would speak in Sicilian.
It's you that I'll be.
And we could speak fluent Sicilian. And whenever Joe Donato was around, he'd also was exactly this. He knew Sicilian, and we'd all talk Sicilian. Hey, what's the name? Let's go have a drink. Pigiamo una cosa, vivemo una cosa bella, un poco di vino.
And all my bright tomorrows belong.
I had a couple of very good friends who had expressed to me that they wanted to own a Scornavacca. They purchased a painting. It was of a girl from the rear bending over, beautiful sepia wash painting. It was a gorgeous painting. Tony got a check. The next morning, Monday, Tony called me and he said, "Harry, I don't want to deposit the check in my account. I want to cash the check at the bank it was drawn at." I said, "Tony, you have to remember something. Don't forget your ID. You can't cash a check without ID." He said, "Oh, I got ID. I got plenty of ID. You know, got it." So I picked him up, and he looked great. Tony did not particularly like to go into banks. So they weren't his kind of people. They were like, just weren't his kind of people. So we went to the bank, and we go up to the teller's window, and this lovely young lady, he shows her the check, and she presses a few buttons, and then she says, "I'll have to see some ID, sir." So Tony says, "Okay," pulls out his wallet and opens it up, and he takes this first sheet of paper and he unfolds it and he puts it on the teller's counter. And he said, "This is my birth certificate. I was born, rah, 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 rah." She says, "Oh, This is my World War II U.S. Army Air Force ID papers. This is my honorable discharge from the U.S. Army. This is my license to show my artwork and sell my artwork in San Francisco at Fisherman's Wharf. You have to have a license to do that. She said, oh, okay. And then she says, sir, may I see your, do you have a driver's license? He says, no, don't drive anymore. No driver's license. He says, okay, do you have a voter's registration? And Tony says, no, don't vote anymore. I don't have a voter's registration. He says, well, I'm sorry, sir, but what you're gonna have to do is see an officer to get the check okay. He says, fine, good, good. He says, well, go over to that lady who's sitting over there and she'll fix you up with an officer. And he walks over to the lady and there's a guard standing there, a bank guard with a gun and uniform and the whole thing. And he walks up to this guard and I'm watching him and he's showing the guard all the papers. And I said, oh my God, what's he doing? You know, and he's smiling, so I know something's coming. And I hear him say, but you're an officer, aren't you? And then he laughs and goes over to the lady. She fixes him up with an officer. He sits down and he's showing him all the papers. So he says, I'm sorry, sir, but I can't get this okayed right now, but if you'll come back in the morning, I'm sure I can have it done for you by then. Tony says, thank you very much. You've been very kind. And I said the same thing. And we get up to leave. And Tony stops. And he's got this puzzled look on his face. And he goes back to the desk. And he leans over. And he puts his hand on this guy's arm. And he looks right into his eyes. And he says, do you believe I'm Tony Scornavacca? And the guy, his mouth falls open. He doesn't know what to say. He can't say, yes, he believes he has to cash a check. But he says again, do you believe I'm Tony Scornavacca? Who else could he be? Who else could he be? How could somebody make this up? Tony Scornavacca with all these papers? And Tony was absolutely astounded that they didn't believe he was Tony Scornavacca. He didn't trust art galleries to represent him and to show his paintings. He thought they were gonna steal from him, and he didn't. So that's why he didn't become nationally known, and that's why his paintings aren't selling for $2 million now. And some of them could be selling for that because they were that good, especially the bathers. It's just unbelievable work, but nobody knew about it other than Coconut Grove and South Florida and a little bit in Atlanta and other places. But because he didn't go with the gallery, never went with a gallery, he didn't become better known.
This town's got all kinds of people, black, white, red, yellow, brown, and even a few green ones. Most of them hang out in places like this, Duffy's Tavern. We went inside a moment ago and asked anybody if they'd like to sing, and one fella, Tony Scornavacca, a Miami artist, said he'd like to sing for us. Let's hear him now.
I'm dreaming of a green Christmas, just like the ones I've always known, where Biscayne Bay glistens, and people listen to hear palm trees swaying to and fro. I'm dreaming of a green Christmas. With every Christmas song I sing, may your days be bright and serene, and may all your Christmases be green.
His parents moved to the United States probably around 1900 or 1910. They raised their family here. They had 9 children in their Italian-American neighborhood of Newark, New Jersey. It was not luxurious in any ways. It was a small home where the 11 people lived and grew up. There was a lot of Italian customs, a lot of Italian cooking, and a lot of that got passed down to our home. So I did have that smell of spaghetti sauce on the stove on a regular basis. My father's Sicilian upbringing really ingrained in him the family values and that were passed along to me and my sisters and my mother. While my father was in art school at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, New York, he got into the commercial art field and with the advertising agencies on Madison Avenue. And this was not his most enjoyable and most productive artistic expressive outlet. He went to the Metropolitan Museum and saw an exhibit of Van Gogh paintings. He was so struck and so inspired by the works of Vincent Van Gogh and the story of Van Gogh also, that he decided that he needed to be a serious painter and produce paintings and sell the paintings, and that would be his livelihood, that would be his art career. So he scrapped the idea of working for an ad agency on Madison Avenue and packed up and moved to Miami, where he decided he would be a real artist, and he was. He would always be giving me and my sisters pencils, pens, paint, brushes, charcoals, paper, canvases, so we could be expressive in our own ways. The house was set up like a gallery, parts of it, the living room, and the studio was actually in the apartment above the garage. We had a detached garage on the property, and his studio was upstairs, and that's where he painted constantly, day and night, sometimes all night. When I walk into an artist's studio and I smell the aroma of turpentine or mineral spirits or oil paint, it's immediately recognizable. It's a familiar smell. It brings me back to my childhood, because since I was born, I was around my father's studio, around the paint, around the oil, around the productivity. And I became involved in it myself. My sisters did, my mother did. So an art studio, the sights and the sounds and the smells are something that's really ingrained into my nervous system. Growing up in our house, there were paintings all over. Paintings, drawings, finished ones, unfinished ones, some that were very personally, that the family was very personally attached to, others that were just put up in haste to cover a crack on the wall or something like that, and also sculptures of my father's friends, his artist friends. There was a lot of trading of artwork, sculptures for paintings, paintings for paintings, One weekend, my father and his artist friends decided that they needed to sell more artwork. So their idea was to take their artwork and put it out on the sidewalk and attract some attention and hopefully get some sales. And they called it the Coconut Grove Art Festival. My father, Gene Masson, Leonard King, Bill Clark, Eddie Way, let's see, Grail Douglas possibly, a photographer, Hank Koch, they put their artwork out on the sidewalk on Main Highway across from where the Taurus restaurant is now. And they lined up their artworks and they sold quite a few. It became quite popular. They repeated it the next year, and 50 years later, it's still going. His most successful period was when he had the gallery on Commodore Plaza. It was set up rather luxuriously, and there was a lot of foot traffic on Commodore Plaza. He was very well known at that time. Usually it would be a combination, gallery in the front, studio in the back, and he would paint all day, and if a customer walked in, he would attend to that customer. And it was funny because the landlords were noticing that my father was a successful artist and he was getting good prices for his paintings, and usually at the end of the lease they would try and jack up the rent. And he was of the mind where he didn't want to tolerate that, so he would move to another studio gallery. My dad was a prolific artist. He constantly painted. I think he painted about 3,000 paintings in his lifetime, because he moved here around 1950. He passed away in 86. So for 36 years, probably 25 of those years were his. He was extremely productive. And if he painted 100 paintings a year for 25 years, that would be 2,500 paintings right there. Not to mention the drawings.
What's your name? He says, Scornavacca. He says, how do you spell that name? He says, S is in Scornavacca, C is in Cornavacca, O is in Ornavacca, S is in Navacca, V is in Vacca, A is in Akka, C is in Kaka, C is in Ka, and A is in A. And he would go through that whole thing, and the whole point is that he would do it all the time. And you would be with him, and you would have to listen to that same. Tony had a gallery in the Grove. We had a two-man show, and I had collage, Tony had paintings, and we called it Two Guys from Newark. And it was another excuse to have a party. He was a great influence on me in terms of his talents. He was a master draftsman and a real wonderful, creative, romantic, artist that I never cease to be amazed at his virtuosity. When I managed fighters in the 70s and 80s, Tony would come to all the fights. Tony was so gifted with his wit and capability of humor. In fact, he got to know Henny Youngman, the comedian, and Henny Youngman would, on many occasions, would call him up to know if he had any jokes he could swipe. And many of Henny Youngman's jokes were Tony's. When he fixed up his garage, after he closed up his studio in the Grove, and it was the garage across the house, and he spent many a day and night fixing that up. And finally, he went over there the first night, and with a bottle of Early Times, and painted and drank and painted and drank and painted and drank, and he was listening to music, went across the courtyard and went upstairs and went to sleep, and gets up and there's music still going from his radio. He goes over to the window, opens up the window, he says, "Hey, goddammit, shut that damn noise. I can't sleep. Close that radio." And your mother got up and said, "Tony, that's a radio you left on in your studio." So he gets up, goes downstairs, goes across the way, goes upstairs, opens up the window at the studio and yells out, "I'll play the radio anytime I want to." Tony went up to the funeral of his mother, and his father had died before that. His sister was alive, and they went to visit the gravesite. He saw one headstone. So Tony said, where's Pop? Where's Pop's gravestone? She said, "No, it's just Tony, this is a double plot. Mama is on top of Papa." He says, "Oh, it's about time." I had a lot of influence from Tony in terms of his capability, his style, his draftsmanship, his virtuosity at the same time. And then one way or another, I would go and see the things that he did, and they evolved into, to a great extent, in the things that I did. But I think that creative people do that with each other, one way or the other. Well, he was the Toulouse-Lautrec of Miami in terms of his lifestyle and circumstance. He was an iconoclastic genius. I miss the character that, you know, and the true essence of the man at the same time, towards the end of his life. I didn't miss the kind of abuse that he did to himself and to people around him, because he was an alcoholic and involved himself in things that, to a degree that I just wouldn't and didn't want to do. The legacy for any creative person should be fundamentally his work. In Tony's case, it's added is to his character, both good and bad.
Yeah, I miss my dad. Well, that's why it's hard to talk, because there's all this art, and growing up, I didn't really recognize my dad as an artist, because he was just my dad. And I think really that says a lot about how he was as a dad. He just loved his children and my mom, and he wouldn't introduce us individually. He'd, like, we'd be standing there, he'd say, "These are my four beautiful children." Oh, it was so embarrassing. Now I can recognize him as an artist, because since he died, I miss him very much. He painted so much and spent so much time with his friends. There was, I would say, "Where's Dad? Why isn't Dad home?" Well, now, after seeing all these paintings, my dad is alive and well in all those, in all that work. It isn't just a piece of him in each painting. There was all of him in that work. So I guess he really dedicated his life to that work. There was so much of him to go around with his family and his friends, and he just brought so much to the table as a dad. All his friends were artistic, and I always mentioned Joe Donato, and music and art and sculpture and just everything. And he would have parties and people, and just we had so much exposure to the world. Even though we lived in Coconut Grove, which is a tiny little place, he just brought the whole world to Coconut Grove. And when I came home after living in New York and LA, I was like, "Well, what happened to the Grove?" Well, my dad was the Grove. My dad and his friends and his artists, they they made that little town. And I'm grateful for having had the opportunity to grow up in Coconut Grove when it was just a little artist community. As much of an artist that my dad was, he was also very, very much a father and a husband to my mom, and he gave me my mom. Those two were crazy. He would say the divorce isn't working out. So they were very much in love their whole life, and that was another example of just love, how to love someone. And something my dad said to me, very, very important, he got off the phone with some art gallery owner that was screwing him over in one manner or another, got taken advantage of a lot business-wise, for whatever reason. He would be furious, and then he would say, but I don't hate, never hate. I never, ever, ever hate. I did say this thing to him one time. He was so impressed with it, and I didn't think it was, That face, he came home, he's sitting there at the table. I was like four. I'm like, Dad, your face is like a crowded city. Your forehead is the open fields and your nose is the center of town. And he was like, beautiful. I was like, what? So he was so impressed. He gave you an exaggerated sense of like how fabulous you were because he was so impressed with any little thing that you did. Mostly he taught by osmosis, just the way he lived his life. No boundaries of love or laughter or joy or humor, very much very important. And you know, life can suck sometimes, but there's always a one-liner in there somewhere. So that's my dad. Just grateful that he was my dad, and he gave me, like I said, my mom, humor, food, music, everything, the whole world. My dad gave me the whole world.
Oh, my dad, what a colorful character. I think of love when I think of my dad. He was the most loving father, super affectionate, very positive, despite, you know, life bringing hard times to him later in life. He's an amazing artist, and I it's taken me a while, I guess, as we grow older, we grow a little wiser and kind of really appreciate where we come from. And I always knew he was a great artist, but when I see his work now, I have some of his work on my walls. We have, my siblings and I have numerous sketches that he did. He was very prolific, and I didn't really get that when I was a kid. I didn't understand what his genius was. But now I really, really appreciate having grown up with that sort of life, the artistic life. My mom was very supportive of him. His friends, the parties we had, the social life, it was very rich and very full. And I thank him for that, and I thank my mother as well for allowing the parties, because they were pretty crazy. But he had musician friends, artist friends, business, some businessmen, I don't recall. But that whole era in the 70s was very accepting, warm, inviting. So, you know, his friends were rich, poor, black, white, male, female, gay, straight. But it's like everyone was one big happy family. And that's something that I kind of have taken with me into my adult life, is that type of just non-prejudiced, accepting type of person. And I think that's, you know, I'm very sociable, and I owe that to my dad and the life that I grew up with, and my mom. So he was my dad, he was always my dad, and you just kind of, whereas his friends may have particular stories they may remember, that's because they were only with him here and there, but I was with him a lot. He was always telling us his jokes, usually repeating them several times over and over at the dinner table, and we'd have to tell him, Dad, really, this one again, really? And he didn't care, he just loved to laugh. always had great meals. He and my mom were both wonderful Italian cooks. And we'd be eating a, you know, big spaghetti dinner, and he'd always encourage us to eat more by saying, mangia, mangia. And I remember like certain little jokes he would tell, like, go to school and don't get smart. And you're not gonna get any dessert unless you eat your pig's feet. And that's the other thing, is that I grew up with kind of different foods from what my friends at school were eating. Pig's feet, oxtails, clams on the half shell. But I grew up with such a wide array of food that now I'm a foodie. Love all different types of food. I don't think there's anything I don't like. I loved when he and my mom were divorced and he lived on his own. I would love to go visit him because he always had a gallery, or a studio, I should say, studio. The smell of his studio when I was little and they were together and we would go visit his galleries in the Grove, or when I got older, he got older and he lived on his own. Going to his studio, I just remember that smell of the paints, the oil paints, the look, just the like a raw feel of art. It was wonderful. The mineral spirits, turpentine, whatever, to clean the brushes. And even to this day, if I walk into maybe like an art store and I sense the smell of supplies, it just takes me right back to my childhood. It's pretty cool. I feel very fortunate to have grown up with that life, because I don't think it's you know, it's not that common to have an artist father, especially from the 70s, have an artist father who was so influential as he was in Coconut Grove. And so I feel very proud, and I miss my dad, and I love him, and I'm thankful for everything.
At one time he called me up. I had moved up to New Jersey to be with my parents, and he says, Joe, this is Tony Scornavacca. Do you remember me? Do I remember you? I can't forget you. You're all over the house here. Everywhere I look is Scornavacca. Tony and I went to the Pavarotti concert, where he was to present a painting of Pavarotti, a portrait. And we did that, and everything turned out nice. And then he felt he had the need to go have a smoke. And so he went outside of the theater. And then next thing you know, Pavarotti started singing, and I heard a big ruckus in the lobby, a fight, kind of a wrestling match, and it was Tony and the ushers didn't want to let him back in. I was inspired and influenced by Tony's process of how he would work. I guess his forte is improvisation, how he could nail you. That means that he has the eye first. Forget about the hand and the skill of, you know, drawing and, you know, making a straight line and controlling the canvas. It's his eye, what he sees, and he could nail you, as he would put it, and see what it was in you that he could capture. And then, boom, he just knock it out and nail you. Well, I called Tony and said, we're gonna have to do a benefit for the, I think it was the people of Honduras who had a hurricane, and we were gonna raise some money, and they'd given us the Coconut Grove Playhouse, and we needed a poster. So Tony said, well, we'll make a poster. So I go over to the house. So I was trying to situate myself so I would, you know, give the best angle of, you know, so you wouldn't see the double chin and how, what should I do, this side or that side, you know, about getting ready. Next thing you know, he says, well, we're finished here, we're done, like this. Done. Well, on the subject of Tony's influence on me, had to do in the areas of improvisation. And of course, you know, the definition of improvisation comes from the Latin word improviso, which means to make the unknown known. And Tony was very good at that. And I think that's my best trait, is I'm able to trust my instincts and just lay it out there. My forte is improvisation. Yes, I also read music, not enough to hurt me, none, but I love to improvise. It inspired me musically to trust in that and to do that. Of course, I, like Tony, am also schooled, but when it comes to actually doing it, I usually trust my instincts and just let it, as we say in Sicily, come esce esce. As it comes out, it comes out. That's what you got. My old
heart. He had, you know, other periods, you know, his Bronzini period, and he loved Picasso and other masters, and he would pay tribute on various works of art.
Right after we did one of the portraits, he says, "Well, when I throw a seven, that means when he dies, I want you to play at my funeral, Angel Eyes." Hey, Tony, I don't want to talk about your demise, and we got to talk about death now. Well, look, I'll do it, okay? I'll do it. I figure, well, because I don't really want to do it, because the funerals is too emotional, you know? So I don't really want to play at funerals, but I told him I would do it. And then I thought it over. I figured, well, he'll be dead. He won't know that I didn't play. And he was estranged from Angie, his wife at the time, so nobody would know that I had made this promise. Well, the day before the funeral, Angie called me up and she said, "Joe, you know the promise you made to Tony." He told her. So there I was at the funeral, crying and trying to play Angel Eyes. His legacy is his family. I'm talking about his ever-patient wife, Angie, his daughter, Anna, Laura, Mia, and Tony Jr. In addition to his beautiful family, it's his contribution to the art world.
Excuse me. While I disappear.
Bon vivant, raconteur, good friend.